My name is Bipin Sen. I'm the regional sales manager at Bosch Rexroth. Here is, as soon as I turn this on, kind of the session content that we will be going through. So like I said, it's a fairly content intensive session. Most of it is designed to actually impart information to you. The product portion of it that I'll be talking about is mainly to serve as examples of what we're doing from the Bosch and Bosch Rexroth side. The agenda for us will go through just some introduction of Bosch and Bosch Rexroth. I see a number of faces here. You're familiar with our company, with our products, but just again, a quick introduction to that. We'll talk a little bit about the concepts behind the phrases that we hear. So things like Industry 4.0 and connected industry and connected automation and IoT and IIoT and all of that, kind of what's, you know, if we coalesce into the phrase of Industry 4.0, well, what does that really mean in terms of a concept? We'll look at an invention of mine called the connected value equation. It just coalesces, and when we get to it, it coalesces a lot of the information that's disparate into a very simple form that we can understand on what it is. How do you make money out of anything connected, be it on the consumer side or be it on the industrial and automation side? What are the key components of anything connected making any money for anyone? We'll look at some basic building blocks of what it takes to have connected automation, connected industry. From the Rexroth side and the Bosch side, we're going to be calling it Factory of the Future. What are some of the key building blocks of that? We'll look at some common myths and misconceptions. What is IoT? What is not IoT? Just some interesting facts on that. Some use cases from how does Bosch use Factory of the Future concepts in our own manufacturing. What can you do? I see OEMs represented here. I see users. What does it mean for you as a takeaway? And then we will finally do a very simple exercise in connecting a couple of different pieces of information. We'll get information off of a sensor. We'll get information off of Control Logic's PLC, and we will display it on a visualization. And I'll take three volunteers for each of these three things, and my goal is to show you how simple it is to actually be able to connect pieces of information and to make it flow from one place into another, and what you can do with that power in your own hands. Okay, next couple of slides, just very, very quickly. So Bosch is roughly a 70 billion euro company. Most of Bosch sales are in the automotive sector. All of you drive cars, of which every car has a Bosch product in it. We are part of the industrial technology division along with our sister company of Bosch Packaging. And the other things that Bosch does are consumer items, dishwashers, power tools, security systems, etc. On the Bosch Rexroth side, I represent the automation and electrification division. We are actually fortunate to have the CEO of the automation and electrification group, Dr. Heine Lang, who's sitting up in the front. He's going to be doing a session right after mine. On a more higher level, connected factor of the future concepts. We're roughly an $825 million company. This is just controls, drives, automation, those kinds of products. Our headquarters is in Lohr, and I am out of the Hoffman Estates, 20 minutes from here facility. And our U.S. headquarters for automation and electrification is right out of this area. Our products and services go under six solution categories. I'm just going to run through three of them pretty quickly. We are the pioneer in motion control. For those of you who go back at least 15 to 20 years, the idea of electronic line shafting was first invented and developed by a company called Indermat, which is what we were back before 2001. So we started with the idea and the technology behind taking servo axes and being able to synchronize them together. We are still the benchmark in drives and control. So every competitor that ever makes a servo drive still compares their technology to ours because we still make the best drives in the marketplace. It's a very bold claim that's warranted now through multi-decades of our components still out there in the field running strong. And the last one is we're leapfrogging our competition by taking the idea of a PLC and lifting it up to the ideas of Internet of Things. And you'll see kind of the concepts behind this claim. But the PLC is no longer just an automation controller. It can now use, process, and do something with data and information that so far was not being able to be done. Okay, let's get into the heart of the session. Connected automation, connected really anything. So I start from the personal use case side. If you open up your smartphone, I can probably bet that half a dozen real world things are connected to your smartphone. So here is a Samsung refrigerator that I just pulled a picture off, right? It's a smart family hub. Bosch is now making lawnmowers that are connected via an app. You can look at the temperature of your steak using Bluetooth things. I mean, that is becoming very common. All right, I'm an Indian guy. I like my living room at 72 degrees. You Wisconsin people, 66 degrees. No. So this is the Ecobee app, you know, that I just pulled last night showing my living room temperature. Right, so we've got all this information that is so readily available and accessible on our personal side, yet how many of you are able to take out your smartphone and look at what state your machine is in, or what your logistics supply chain looks like, or what the uptime is on the five machines that you have sitting out in three different plants, right? Really none of us have that kind of information. Well, why not, right? And that's the key question of really why all of you are sitting in here and why I'm talking about it. Because the idea of connecting things is common to us in one part of our life, and yet there's a firewall between our personal side and what we're willing to do and things that happen on the plant floor, on the shop floor. And why is that? Well, is security really the main reason behind it, or what? We'll get into that. Just the fact that you are sitting in this room means you are in that 95% that say that IoT-based projects will have a significant business impact. 84% people believe that IoT is an effective solution for the future. These are just some claim statements showing that IoT is really now kind of a buzzword that is out in full force in the industrial space. Some concepts time. This is the part where we just define a few different things. What is Industry 4.0? What is the fourth industrial revolution? So the first one was mechanization, right? We moved from doing things by hand to doing things by steam power and coal power. The second one was Henry Ford, assembly line operation. So doing, making one thing and making a lot of it and gaining efficiencies from it. The third industrial revolution is where most of us in this room really were part of. This is the late 70s, 80s revolution of PLCs and microcontrollers that took efficiencies and really ratcheted them up. So this is the age of the semiconductor. And the fourth industrial revolution is in essence about data and information. So it's how do you connect different pieces of machines, different pieces of sensors, different logistics processes. Really, it's taking data from one part and making it visible and accessible across every part and every user and every process that uses this data. So that's the fourth industrial revolution. It's utilizing information and data in a way that was not being able to, that was not used before, right? So keep this in mind in whenever we talk about connected automation, connected anything, it's all referring to information. It's all referring to data and what you do with that data. Okay. So more concepts that define Industry 4.0. So it's the intersection really of us as people working in processes, working with technology, really hardware, and working with information, becoming faster, more productive, and making sure we're not locked down into one ecosystem. So how to become faster? You can now do virtual engineering. This is the idea of digital twins. You can create a machine in software that mimics and looks exactly like it would if you were building it for real, and you can do different iterations and things like that on a software basis. Once you have that, that's when you cut your first steel. It's using information in a way that's more efficient and proficient than before. How can we become more productive? How can we share information from one process to another process, making the second process more intelligent? An open standard, so this is a big thing for Bosch, and you'll see it repeated a few times over. How can you make a process, how can you make a product, how can you make a solution that as technology evolves, you can evolve with it without being cornered into that particular piece of technology? So I don't know if my friend Brian Schmidt is in this room. 10 years ago, he bet on HD DVD being the technology that would take over the world instead of Blu-ray. And he bought an HD DVD player, right? And about 4 years later, it went into the trash because Blu-ray won out as a standard, right? So for those people that thought that HD DVD would be the standard, they were left behind. How can you be on a standard? Now, Blu-ray is also a standard, and you're locked into that if Blu-ray decides to go away. How can you adopt processes and standards that as things evolve, you don't get locked and stay behind? How can you be on standards that are open, that allow you to change and evolve as things go on? It's really the graphic that I want you to look at, more so than the text that goes on it. This shows really the connection between different plants, processes, and information flowing across the entire value stream. So things that happen in one plant, the problems and the errors and the things that are done to fix those errors, can that information seamlessly flow from one place to the other place so that plant two doesn't have to go through the same pain process that plant one already went through? How can that information flow without somebody turning on the spigot or somebody turning off the spigot or being transferred in a way that is transparent across everything? So Industry 4.0, it's a unification of the real world, the world that we live in, with the virtual world of internet and information technology. It's people, machines, and IT systems exchanging information, right? So again, we come up to this point of information and data being the key underlying factor that's revolutionizing this Industry 4.0. And then technology is supporting the people. In the end, the goal of this is to make our lives easier, to make everybody's life easier in everything that we do. So that's the goal of the apps in your smartphone, right? It makes your job easier. And that's, in the end, the goal of really connected automation, connected industry. How can we make the person on the floor, the person sitting behind a laptop, the person with a checkboard, how does their life become easier? This is a key factor for Bosch. It's not a key factor for a couple of the other suppliers that I've worked with, that I've talked to, that talk about connected automation. So one of the key things for us is, how can you make production and processes efficient enough that you can make one of something, but make it in such a way that you have the efficiencies of mass production, right? So we call it a batch size of one or a lot size of one. But you're making a batch size or a lot size of one like you were making a million of those same things. Is that possible? Now, a lot of it is aspirational, but that's the goal of that aspiration, is to get down to a lot size of one without saying that I have to do new tooling, I have to do setup costs, and on and on and on. How can you get to that point? And then really for a way on the bottom, it's a way out of commoditization. So if you are in the commoditization business, then somebody comes, either that commodity goes out of vogue or somebody else comes up with a better way of making that same commodity, well, then you are out of luck. So gaining these efficiencies allows you to be to find a way out of your products being commoditized. Just a quick primer on really where are the world's most industrialized companies and countries in terms of these emerging technologies. Well, the US, we know, is the bastion of software innovation. So eight out of the top 10 software companies are all based in the US, and all based, most of them based out of the Silicon Valley. So we lead the world in terms of the way we think about software and the deployment and acceptance of software-based solutions. The concepts and ideas for Industry 4.0 really are European in nature. So the thinking behind it, the theories behind it, and all of that really are germinating out of Europe. But Europe is very slow in putting those concepts into practice. So it's a nature of the way companies are formed over there. It's a nature of a very cautious approach to automation. And so Europe has the danger of generating these concepts, but like as it says on the slide, becoming a technical museum, right? You go there to see things that were developed for the future, but yet are not being used in life as it is today. And let's not forget about China, right? So is China a workbench for California, right? Everything that we have that I can see visible on our desks was made in China, right? Every high-tech piece of automation. It was made using production processes and technologies that were given from the West, but let's not forget that the Chinese are smart people themselves. And so China has at this point, they have the biggest onus to leapfrog each one of us and become really the next industrial giant of the world. So they have some initiatives that that are enforced right now. This Made in China 2025 initiative and a couple of others that are really putting a lot of emphasis on development of new technologies within the Chinese sphere of influence. On the Bosch side, I think so this is going to be just the first slide on how Bosch is using the ideas behind Factory of the Future. Bosch, in its nature, is a manufacturing company. Right? We manufacture a lot of the little things, a lot of big things, 270 plants worldwide and counting. So a lot of the ideas that are presented in this talk, in the products that we do, are supplied by internal Bosch companies. So we develop products, processes, ideas that really get tested within the Bosch production environment. And once they are kind of perfected and useful, we then offer it to the open marketplace. So a lot of the sensors that that we'll talk about, a lot of software systems that you'll see a little bit later on, were all used and for about 10 years now in different Bosch plants. And now that they are kind of perfected, we can now talk about it and offer it in the open market. So that's why I can stand here in front of you and talk about some of these ideas, because we've already been using them in our own plants for a number of years. So it's not just theory for us and we're looking for an alpha or a beta customer to test that theory on. It's something we've already been doing in our plants and we know it works. That's why we can offer it to you with a claim statement attached to it. From the Rexroth side, we have three ways that we deal with this technology. First one is Bosch directly in the Bosch plants. The second is working with OEMs to make their machines smarter, to make their machines connected, and then working with the end user. So if you're an OEM, working with your customers, really on more on their production and their processes and logistics. They're getting their machines from the OEM, but what can Bosch has also other solutions that offer support and help on the production logistics side of it. So that's where our we work with the end users directly, more on a consulting and software basis. Okay, let's get into this connected, how to make money out of connected anything. The three distinct elements is what I say. I mentioned this in my opening, needed for any connected solution. All right. The first one is sensing. How is data generated? So these are hardware devices. So to get information to do connected automation, you first need to generate data. So hardware devices can be edge devices that produce data, or they can be sensors, they can be I/O, they can be smart components, and that's what I say when I talk about some products in the slides coming up. It's just examples of how different products that we have that help generate this data. All right. The next thing you need to do, you've generated a lot of data, but what do you do with this? So the next element of this is you need to process that data somehow. So these can be hardware devices that aggregate this data, put it all together. This can be a cloud service. You take the data, you put it up into the cloud, and you retrieve it from the cloud to the place that you want to use it. Machine learning algorithms or software systems that visualize data. You know, you have OEE boards when you walk down a plant. Those boards are merely displaying information. Right, it's not really doing anything. It's to me it's the part of processing information that's generated from the hardware devices and sensors that are on the machine. So you've got sensing, you've got processing. The third element is service. Now what do? So you've got the data, you've processed it, you've made it look really pretty, but then what? What happens then? What's the service that wraps everything around this? And this is really where everyone in industrial automation is now at. What service can we provide to the sensors, to the processing that we can do? What's really the service that comes as a result of this? Most companies have ways of generating data, processing, and retrieving it in varieties of ways, but what is the use of all of this for the user? For the person who buys the machine from you, what's the use of all of this for them? What's the service that goes around it? My next slide says how to rule the world, right? So about 20 years ago, late 90s, we had these devices that showed up. I remember going to Best Buy to buy this little Dell stick, right? These were MP3 players. You could put thousands and thousands of songs onto your little hardware device. I don't know how many of you actually ever bought one and you tried to use it, but the way to do it was you took a CD, you put it in a PC, you ripped the CD into MP3s, you clicked and dragged those MP3s into your stick, and then you had 1,000 songs onto your device. My daughter is really into Korean pop, K-pop, and we just bought a couple of CDs for her, and she wanted it on her iPhone. It's not on the online, so we actually did the same thing, and she's like, "What are you doing?" You know, it's like ripping a CD. I'm like, that just sounds so aggressive. Why is it called ripping? I mean, so a 13-year-old that has no idea of what an MP3 is, right? I mean, and they don't need to know. Because for them, it's on Spotify or it's in Pandora, and you know, this stuff just works. Anyway, that's a side point on ripping CDs. Okay, 2004, this device came out, right? Remember this little thing? And this software that showed up? It was literally on the back of this hardware that Apple is the company it is now. The iPhones came much later. The MacBook was never a big commercial success. It's still not the dominant platform today. It was this iPod and the ability to get music from the App Store to the iPod that allowed Apple to become the company it is today. And this thing does everything that the previous sticks did. Only they figured out a way to do it better. They bypassed about 4 steps needed, and now you could do things easily that nobody else had figured out to do. It was a service that they provided that made them take off and made them what they are today, right? So it's really this part of it that I talked about, right? So the service, once you add the service element to this equation, that provides some value to your user. And that value, right, then equals revenue for both the OEM, so the OEM that's providing the machine, that's providing the solution, that's providing the spare parts, that's providing the service contract, that's providing maintenance services to the OEM and to the user. It's revenue, it's dollars to the user, in terms of higher uptime, lower maintenance costs, higher productivity, less downtime, and on and on and on. Faster supply chain, faster time to market. It's a value in two different ways, but all of that has to work together in generating some value to the end user, right? Does that, I hope that's kind of gelling and coalescing in your minds. Okay, we'll look at the next few slides are going to be examples from the Bosch side of what products and things we have that encompass sensing, processing, and service from our side. Now, I'll be honest and frank. If we had the killer service thing, then nobody else would be out there. I again go back to the fact that the service part is the one that you have to figure out what your customer wants, and you have to wrap that service around that, right? Uber figured out that nobody wants to call 1-800-TAXI-CAB and the dispatch guy saying, I'll have a cab to you in 30 minutes, and 40 minutes later, you're still wondering where the guy is, right? They figured out that if you have an app and you can exactly see where your driver is and he made the wrong left turn, right, that's the service that they provide. They figured out that the user wants total transparency of knowing where his driver is, right? That's the service that they have. They're using the GPS chip on your phone. They're using web services and cloud storage provided by most likely Amazon. They're most likely using geolocation services provided by Google. And they just made an app that wraps everything together, right? It's an app of a company that's now $1 billion. But it's the service. They looked at their customer base, that they knew what the customers want, and they figured out how to do it. On the industrial side, that's what we have to do. That's the missing piece. What do our customers want, and how can we wrap all of this together into something that is easy to use, deploy, maintain, and replicate? All right. Sensing. So these are, if you remember, these are hardware devices that generate data. How do you generate data to be able to use in the first place? So we'll look at some things. Smart devices. So you can have. So this i3.0 is really industry 3.0. So previous generation sensors, and really what could be sensors for the fourth industrial revolution, for industry 4.0. So a little prox sensor like this. We make sensors that are, we'll actually play with this little sensor later on. Bosch makes a little sensor like this. It's got seven sensors in it, light, sound, accelerometer, et cetera. It's got a Bluetooth radio in it. It's got Wi-Fi in it. Stick it on your machine, grab data for a day, take it out and put it away to use it a week later. So a connected sensor. This is the more industrial version of it, an IP60 sensor or IP54 sensor, but a little ruggedized version of the same sensor. On the corner over there, actually that's the picture, it's called our IoT gateway. What this allows you to do is, it allows you to take analog signals, digital signals, it allows you to probe third-party PLCs like a Control Logix or a Siemens or a Beckhoff. So without changing any of the program running inside those PLCs, it can actually interrogate the global variable list, the global parameters out of those PLCs. And now you can use data that's already living inside those PLCs without changing anything. So if you've got a Control Logix application out there and the end user doesn't want you to touch anything on it, you could take this IoT gateway, connect up to it, and actually extract information from it without writing anything to it. So this, to me, becomes a data aggregator, a data collection box that you can use on new machines, on old machines, and all it's doing is it's taking information from sensors, from PLCs, and then feeding it upstream to wherever you want it to. You can connect up to a cloud service, it can connect up to a database, it can connect up to an Excel if you wanted to, et cetera. So what you're doing is taking information and then feeding it to wherever you want it to, just visualizing it, for example, maybe a service that that your customer wants. I just want to see what this thing is doing running continuously on a 65-inch board. Drive, so drives of the past, anybody's standard servo drives. Well, we have drive systems that are that can be connected to the Ethernet, that can have apps running inside of it. You can use this drive as a torque sensor, so the motor is running as a motor, but now the resolution is of such high accuracy that you can actually see what kind of vibration or torque ripples are happening on the load side. Controllers that were just controllers before, PLCs that were just PLCs, well now the PLCs can be connected to the internet. You can be connected to smartphones and tablets. You can write to it using open languages. You can use LabVIEW to talk to a control if you want. So really, the idea of opening up controls to the outside world. So it's not, again, not a closed ecosystem, but it's an open ecosystem. Linear components. So we are used to thinking of linear systems as just purely mechanical things. What if you put a sensor? So it's a similar sensor as what's in this one. But now, But now you can sense, when on a linear guide, you can sense shock levels, you can sense G-forces, you can sense if the user drove it into an end block and said, I don't know, it just stopped working. But you have information, right? It's a black box for a purely mechanical system. So the limit is not just on things that you plug in electrical systems, but things like mechanical linear rails or even hydraulics. All of this stuff is no longer the purview of just mechanical or, you know, electro-hydraulic systems. These can now be connected up and you can get information. Again, the idea for connected automation is getting information out of things, right? So that's why this is part of the sensing part. This is generating data for you. Now what you do with that data comes later, but these are all data generators at this point. This is fairly common. Now this is in use across at least the aerospace industry and automotive, where you are keeping information for every torquing that you're doing on every bolt. You can store that information using our wireless enabled torquing devices, our nut runners. Let's jump onto the processing side. So the first one is web connector. So this is where you get information from our devices, our controls, using web-based applications. So reading things in an open way. The next one is open core, where you can write information to our devices, to our controls, using a variety of different methods. Down here on the bottom, you can see LabVIEW, MATLAB, Eclipse, Lua, and on and on. There's about 30 different ways of writing things to our devices. So this productivity agent is a set of apps that are in our drives that allow you to use the information that is generated by our motors and then do something with it. So for example, there's an inbuilt mechanical analysis that allows you to know when your belts are wearing out or when there's backlash in gears. And it's an inbuilt app that's already in the drive. You run it to see if there's any backlash or if there's a loosening of the belt, and the drive itself will do that analysis and give you an output. Same thing, is it following an envelope curve that we want it to follow? If it's out of it or below it, then you get a flag or a warning coming out of it. So again, it's a way of processing data and information that's already being generated by devices on the machine. Data analytics server is now a software service from our side that allows you to do condition monitoring, process monitoring, diagnostics, etc. Just another way of now kind of processing and massaging and visualizing and storing data and information. I'll run through a couple of quick services. This is just our first crack at using the connected thoughts and ideas. And really, we'll see in the end, there is no end to what can be done. Odin is a service that we use mostly for end-user support for our hydraulic products. It's a condition-based monitoring system. This active cockpit, if you go across any of our production floors across the world, you'll see this board here. It's a replacement for KPI boards. So it's a touchscreen board that shows live KPI data, not just run once per shift or not just run once per day, but it allows you to now then be able to react and see live and active information as it's happening on the plant floor. Active Assist is a smart work station where using, it's a pick-to-light system. You can have a camera that's looking at the operator hands, make sure they're picking the right thing, making sure they're picking the right tool. If they're not doing anything in the right order, you'll get a warning, et cetera. So it's using lots of different sound detection, cameras, lights, et cetera, to make sure that things are being done in the right order of things to get 100% quality of the product in the end. The Bosch Production Manager, Performance Manager, is another software-based tool. This is the one that I talked about. We work with the end users. It's, again, a condition monitoring system, but it also has the ability of generating work tickets, workflows, events tracking, and then sharing of ticket information across multiple plants, multiple machines, different shifts, et cetera. And then the Bosch IoT suite has a number of, depending on the use case, different levels of solutions, hardware, software, or consulting that can be implemented. If this is a picture of a plant floor with some inbound and outbound logistics, the idea is that everything in the plant floor is connected. That everything is talking to each other. You have full awareness of time, space, and events across your entire production floor. And all the services and things that I talked about get integrated together. So it's one heck of an integration job, but the idea is that everything has awareness of everything else around it. Right, but what else, right? So what's the solution for you, right? That's what we have on our side. What can you do that has all of this put together and that has people running to your door, right? People stand in line outside every time there's a new iPhone release, right? What could we have that has people standing outside in a line for our services and our products? It's an unknown. I honestly don't have an answer for that. If I did, you would know it. But that's why we're all here. This is relevant for those of you who came up from north yesterday. So I talked about that connected automation is to make life easier, right? But that's also not true, because when I looked at it, there's an app called the Shoveler app. You can find a guy who's available who can come in and shovel your driveway for you. So it's use cases. People are there are lots of clever people with lots of clever ideas, and there's a lot of clever people in this room too. So what can we come up with? Okay, we're at the last third of our session time here, and then we go into some hands-on stuff, and then I think we'll have some time for questions and ask me whatever you like. Some IoT myths, misconceptions, and fears. Okay, so first one is everything will change tomorrow. No, not, you know, it's an evolutionary process. Things are going to change. This is now on the industrial side. Things are changing. They're going to change, but not everything's going to change tomorrow, right? We'll still have our jobs to go back to come Wednesday. There's magic in data analytics. No, you know, random data can give accurate results. This chart is people who die in swimming pool deaths based correlated with the number of movies Nicolas Cage is out in every year. So that there's a 66% correlation there. Well, it's really so. Another one, old equipment. This is now a true one. Old equipment can't tell me anything, right? So also not true. So one of the very first examples that we showed is 3 years ago now at the Hanover Fair. We took Robert Bosch's old original lathe, put a speed sensor on it, and now you could actually tell if your belt was tensioned properly enough so that the speed of the wheel was at the right point, so you could make the right product. So you could actually take sensors into old machines and make them now more intelligent. So for all of you out there with machines that were deployed, you know, 5, 10, 15 years ago, or even last year that you think are gone, they are generating gigabytes of data every day, right? And all of that data is so it's a gold mine out, you know, and you just have to come up with the right way of harvesting that information and that data. And once you do something with it, people will pay you for it because it makes them more efficient. It gives them longevity on equipment that they think is gone and done with. So old equipment will tell you lots of things. I need to retrofit my entire plant. Also, again, not true. You can start in stages and sequence in small things, one thing at a time. You aren't big enough to do that. No, you're at exactly the right size that you need to be able to deploy these solutions. You just have to work with the right partner. Okay, what's the fear? Right? And this is obvious, right? If you run centrifuges making nuclear material, your centrifuges will spin out of control and you will lose your plant. So everybody is afraid that they're going to get hacked, their IP is going to get stolen, the machines are going to get destroyed, people are going to get information out, right? IT security for the industrial plant floor is more than what you would do in your life, sometimes it goes a little bit overboard. But that's the fear, that if we open up our networks, if we open up our data on the industrial side, it's something bad is going to happen. So it's a definite roadblock, but there's ways around it. So that's the point of it. But that's a very real fear when you talk about anything connected with your customers. How am I going to protect it? What's going to happen to it? You know, I don't want to give you an open network. You can't dial into my machine unless you're physically here, and on and on and on. So the threat of hacking and disruption is a very real one. A couple of examples of how we are doing, just some use case examples just at Bosch. These are not customers, but really within Bosch what we're doing. Um, data storage. So this is taking data from our one of our plant locations and storing it on the Oracle Cloud. So this was a use case working with Oracle. Oracle is our systems partner, and this was a way of us showing our the ability to, of taking our data, again, using the IoT gateway and using the Oracle Cloud as a data storage facility. This is an actual use case where we, in this particular plant, what they were doing was predictive maintenance, changing out oil filters at a given maintenance schedule. The idea of predictive maintenance versus preventative maintenance is probably the best and easiest revenue generating idea that you can use for your customers. So all of us have, we're used to 3,000 miles, 3 months, right? Oil changes as preventative maintenance. Most of your cars don't need that. Same thing on machines. You need to oil your bearings every so often. You need to tighten your belts every so often. Downtime on the machines, changing out mechanical components because they might break. And you don't want forced downtime, so you schedule in planned downtime. Well, what if your machines could tell you when they are degrading, right? So you can do predictive maintenance instead of preventative. This was our use case. Instead of changing out the oil filters every so often, you only change, you monitor the quality of the oil filter, of the oil, and you change it when it needs to be changed. So putting a couple of sensors, putting the IoT gateway data collector, year and a half was the ROI on the thing. Filters don't cost a lot, but over time it paid back for itself. 25% less maintenance costs. Now you have a guy doing it a quarter of the time or three quarters of the time instead of every so often. This is an example of a manufacturing line in China. High variance in the products that are being developed, and they got a lot of efficiencies out of it by doing this deployment of these different concepts that that we've talked about. Active cockpit we've already talked about, from paper KPI boards to digital whiteboards. I've talked about the track and trace one. The multi-line, so this is valve production in our Hamburg plant, and 200 valve variants. And this is the one where we're trying to get down to a batch size of one. Can you make one valve out of a 200 variant valve with the same cost as you would if you were to run 1,000 of them? And so far, we're actually pretty successful in it. There's some numbers here. These slides are available for your use afterwards, so feel free to look at the savings and all that in your own time. Example of a digital twin, this is a press that we have in Lohr. They can do some changes and adaptations to it on a software basis first, make sure the clearances are right, make sure nothing is working against each other. And once that is done, then they actually run the actual press without running into the problems of an accident taking place. Partnerships. Mr. Denner, from the CEO of Bosch, has made a very clear commitment in terms of Bosch developing technologies and products that are open and employing open standards. So we don't want our customers to be locked in to anything, let alone the Bosch world. So we have, depending on the product category and the service, we have partnerships with a variety of companies across multiple technologies. So not going through everything, but I just want to give you an overview of the picture that really anyone that you can think of that is in the technology sector, we are partnering with them. including you'll be hearing 5G. Illinois just passed a ruling to start deploying 5G radio antennas around the state. So the next generation of high-speed wireless data, Bosch is actually a member, along with Nokia, defining some standards on data transfer and information transfer on that. Okay, how do you sell a concept? So if you are an OEM and you have users that are hearing about connected automation, connected industry, how do you sell this concept? Well, for most emerging concepts, right, you sell it to the early adopters. These are the people who are either early adopters, startups, they have them at their small company, they want to have a first to market mentality, or they are in a competitive marketplace, it's a crowded marketplace, and they want to have a competitive edge, right? So again, you have to identify the users and the customers that that you're going to be talking to. You have to identify who you need to talk to. The guy on the shop floor may or may not be the right guy. These ideas generally are starting up at the top, and you need to start from the top, talk to the presidents and the CEOs and the VPs of manufacturing, and then work down to the engineering level where those are the guys that will be deploying these ideas. So again, talking to the right people is needed. But your own traditional users, you have to let them know that you are ready for it, because when the time comes and they want to use it, the first thing they need to remember is, I know that Bipin came and talked to me about that, and they have a solution for me. So you can't forget them, but you know, the ones that will want to use it first are the ones that are in the first bullet segment there. Again, start small. You can do small things, one thing at a time. You don't have to do an entire deployment. You don't have to have 10 active cockpits on your floor. You can start with one. You don't have to buy 8 IoT gateways. You can do one, test it across different machines, see which one it works on, which one is a better fit, and go with that. You don't have to reinvent the wheel. Do your homework, do your research. You all know me now after this session. Ask questions, feel free to email or find out, hey, can you do this? If we can do it, I'll let you know we can do it. If we can't do it, I'll tell you we can't do it. But you don't have to reinvent the wheel on everything that you think might be a problem. Work with somebody that's done it before, right? We have talked about this a few different times. Where are the opportunities? This is a US-based organization, Industrial Internet Consortium. They identified 15 markets where the ideas of connected and or industrial Internet of Things would be of interest. I guarantee you, every single one of you sitting in this room is involved in one of these industries. Basically, it means everybody can use it. If you are in any kind of manufacturing, logistics, supply chain, anything to do with anything, you can use the IoT concepts in your line of work.